So the noise that you're in the background, this is the tractor plowing the field. So what we're going to talk about in this video is just about vectors in Euclidean space. So an introduction to linear algebra. But what I want to motivate for is to make your notes inside of a computer coding environment and to use that computer language to help you understand the topic. And also to prepare you for the future. If you're going to learn linear algebra, linear algebra is used in many fields, from data science to engineering, physics. It's just used everywhere. You might as well learn to use linear algebra with a coding language. So I think there are many positives, and it's easy to motivate for the fact that you should do your work with a computer language. So we're going to use Julia. Julia is a language for scientific computing. And we're going to use one of its coding environments called Pluto, which is a notebook which runs inside of your browser. And I've got other videos here on YouTube which just shows you how to use and install it. This video though is about vectors and about Euclidean space. And so our notes are going to be nice and neat. And we're also going to use just a bit of easy, very simple code just to check our results using vectors in Euclidean space. So I'm not going to do a bunch of proofs. If you want a video on the proofs, you'll hear me mention in the video, then certainly make one, and I'll try and make some notes available that is very clear and precise about how to construct the proofs and when you are dealing with vectors in Euclidean space. So let me show you what it looks like to do your work, to do your linear algebra, and to study really using a computer language inside of a coding environment.
I've opened the Pluto notebook, and as you can see, there we go, the whole lot. So everything is typed, all the notes are available in the link down below, so you can load this notebook for yourself. So vectors in Euclidean space, yes, you can do your mathematics work right here inside of a Pluto notebook. It looks very neat. As you can see, you can draw figures there. You can write very beautiful code. And I'll just along the way show you. So it's a lot to learn. We're going to learn about vectors in Euclidean space. We're going to learn how to do calculations in the Julia language, and then also how to generate a notebook such as this. So these are the cells right at the top. So you'll see there's a little eyeball sign there with a line through it that show and hide the code. So if I open that, we can see the code. So in the Pluto notebook, of course, the code is below the cell, is at the bottom of the cell, and you see the execution up above. The MD stands for markdown, and then a set of quotation marks, open and close quotation marks, and inside of there would go some normal English. So there's my name, but there's also that little greater than sign, and that indicates to Pluto that it should make this background here and make the code or make the execution at least of that cell look good. And I can just hide the code there, and you see the pluses on top of the bottom. So if I wanted to insert a new cell to write some code, that'd be fine. So here's my title, and that will also be a markdown cell, so MD with an open and closed set of quotation marks there. And then we're going to use these hashtag symbols in a space. So a single hashtag, that will be the largest text, that will be an H1 tag in HTML. And if I open the setup, you'll see the setup slightly smaller, the text than the title. So this will be one smaller, so two hashtags there. And that's just how you do it. You can go up to six hashtags. That'll be the smallest. But you put the MD and the opening closing quotation marks there to indicate that a cell is just a markdown cell, as opposed to a cell with some code in. And here we see the code. And if you're familiar with Julia, You'll have to be a little bit familiar with Julia before we start with this. But what I've done here with the setup, I've created a computer variable called file, and I'm using the assignment operator. And in quotation marks, I've got this address to this project.toml file inside of this folder structure on my hard drive. And that project.toml file, that is a specific environment for which we have this linear algebra with Julia, this project that I do have. And you can watch my video, the link in the description down below, how to set up a notebook and a Julia environment. So we're going to use the package, PKG package. We're going to then use pkg.activate to activate this project.toml file by just passing file as an argument to the activate function there. We're also going to use the linear algebra package that's built into Julia. We can use the plots package with a plotly backend. So you'll have to install those in this environment. And again, the link will show you in the description, will show you how to do that. And we can also use the random module or random package that's built in, and then also Pluto UI. So you'll have to install Pluto UI as well. So that's the setup. So that is how you bring extra functionality into Julia and how you activate this environment. So a little bit then about what this video is all about, just vectors in Euclidean space. So, you know, we use vectors quite a lot. They're important as mathematical objects, as physical objects. They find the uses in data structures, in engineering, physics, many other fields. Throughout this notebook, we're going to just be concerned with these vectors in Euclidean space. So that's the fundamental space in classical geometry, where we have the real number line. As you can see here, if we get to points, let's get to those points. Remember, we have the real number line, and then we have the Cartesian plane. That's our two real number lines, orthogonal to each other, with an intersection at x equals 0 and y equals 0. All those x's are real numbers, all the y's are real numbers, and that gives us these the ability to plot these points in a Cartesian plane. If we add another orthogonal axis to that, another real number line, the z line, according to the right-hand rule, we now have Euclidean space, three-dimensional space, etc. So just have this point. Now, point requires two real numbers in these axes that you see, an x-axis and y-axis. Remember, they're both real numbers. So we create this two-tuple. A tuple is just a set of values, and there are two of them in this instance. So if we want to plot a point in the Cartesian plane, we need a two-tuple. And so there we see a point there, p3,2. So a point, we'll use uppercase letters and then no space, open close parenthesis, 3,2. So that means on the first real number would be 3. So a 3 along this, and you can see the 3 there at the bottom, and then 2 along the second real line. So I'm just taking two elements, one from each set of real numbers, and that gives me this idea of R2. By the way, back and forth between code and the notebook and the actual topic under discussion, vectors in Euclidean space. So let's just look at this. So if I open that to show the code, again, that'd be a markdown cell. There we go. So it's got to have the open and close set of quotation marks. And how would I do that two as a number? Well, we use LaTeX, and all LaTeX code goes inside of a set of dollar symbols. And there we go. Here at the end, this double struck R, or blackboard R, to indicate a set of real numbers. That'll be backslash math BB for math blackboard, and then R, and then shift 6 on my keyboard for the caret symbol 2. That means the uppercase or superscript 2. And again, all of that is in a set of dollar symbols to indicate to the notebook that this is LaTeX code. And that's just how you construct these. So I'm showing you here so that I can pique your interest, so that you can go look up and explore for yourself how to do this. So there's our figure. We're going to use the plots package for that. And in Pluto, remember, if I have more than one line of code, I've got to wrap that into a begin and end statement. And so I'm going to make x this array with a single value in it, 3, y, I'm going to assign the computer variable y to this array with a single value 2. Then I'm going to say plot x, y. And the series type is a symbol. And symbol in Julia is always a colon, then a word. So this will be colon scatter. That's the scatter symbol telling the plot function here that we want a single or scatter plot at least. And I'm giving it a title. There's one of the arguments, figure 1. So that's where the figure 1 comes. Show axis is false. And the label is point. So 3,2 is going to be this point up here. So I can just click on that point to isolate it. Well, and anyway, here at the top, you can see I can download this as a PNG. We can zoom in a little bit and then we can go back home, etc. And that's why I love Plotly, because we have this great interactivity. Now we've got this point on a real number line. Now we've got this point in a plane, but we needn't stop there, of course. We can go to the Cartesian plane, and rectangular coordinates there will be three elements. And we can go up from there. And we just denote hyperspace there as this double struct R, or blackboard R with a superscript N. So that just means, you know, we can go beyond three space. So let's look at vectors as geometric objects. So what I can do with this point is, let's connect the origin to the point, such as that I have this little arrow. So this would be the tail of the arrow at 0, 0, and that will be the head of this arrow at the point. And now this makes it a vector. So instead of just a point, I now have a vector. And the idea behind this vector would be that it has a magnitude, we'll see. It is of a certain length. And it makes a certain angle with a positive x-axis. So there'll be an angle. So this vector idea as a physical object, a geometric object at least, is just going to be this something that has a length and a direction. But you can see clearly it comes from a point. And I needn't have the tail at the origin. Later on we'll see that the tail can be anywhere. But if we bring it down so that the tail is at the origin here, it becomes a what we call position vector. So it's easy to understand or intuitively understand a vector as this geometric object. But we're more interested in vectors as mathematical objects. So there are various ways that we can denote this, how we can write this. Usually we'll name a vector in your textbook. It'll usually be a boldface lowercase symbol. So that's a boldface there, U. So let's just open this up back to the notebook just to pique your interest. So this is how it's done. It's a markdown cell. We see it's in the opening and closing dollar symbols. So that's going to be LaTeX code. And to get the boldface U would be mathbf. So that's backslash mathbf, so that's a keyword in LaTeX, U, that goes inside of the set of curly braces. And then this large angle brackets, we do that with a left, backslash left, less than symbol, and then close it with a backslash right, greater than symbol. And that changes it to these big angle brackets, and then just the 3, 2 inside of there. So it's very easy to pick up at least this type or the subset of LaTeX that's used in notebooks. Anyway, so we can use these angle brackets to denote this vector 3, 2. So it'll go from the origin to the point 3, 2 in the Cartesian plane. We can also use this column vector notation. And in linear algebra, you'll see a lot of this column vector. And column vectors, we can write them with those angle brackets or with the large parentheses. Doesn't really matter. And then we have the fact that we have the different axes here. So the first one will be at the top, and then the second one, if we had a third one, as we can see here, U, our vector is an element of R3. So we'll have X, Y, and Z. But I told you we needn't stop there, so just in some generic vector as an element of Rn will have components. These are all called components, and we write them down here as a single column vector. Column meaning there's a single column, multiple rows. So we spoke about this length idea of a vector, so let's look at that magnitude of a vector. Now it's very easy to work out the magnitude of a vector, even if I didn't tell you, you would know. Because if I have a vector like that, I can just close it off as this right angle triangle, and if I have a right angle triangle, that becomes the hypotenuse. The vector is now the hypotenuse, and we all know how to calculate the length of the hypotenuse. We just use the Pythagorean theorem. So that'll be just the square root of this component, the x component, plus the square root of the square of these two added to each other. So it's the square of the x component, the square of the plus the square of the y component, and we just take the square root of that, and that gives us the hypotenuse. So you can see again how I just constructed use some Julia code in the plots library to construct that little figure 3 there. So what we have here, and I'm going to use both of the terminologies that we have. This almost looks like an absolute symbol there, so the absolute value of minus 3 is 3. So you can have the double lines there or the single lines. You're going to use both. For you, I've just used the single lines. But clearly that's a bold face U, so that's a vector. And it's just the square of all the components. And with the Pythagorean theorem, we need not just stop at a Cartesian plane. We can go up into hyperspace. And that means I just square all the components, add all of that, those squares, and I take the square root of that. So let's say in Julia, we have this idea of creating a vector in Julia. So I'm going to call my vector u, so that's a computer variable, and I assign something to that. So how computer language works, remember, or Julia at least, is this single equal sign is an assignment operator. It assigns what is to the right to what is to its left. So look, let's have a look at what is to its right. To its right is this two values separated by a semicolon, and it's enclosed in these square brackets. That denotes a certain type, and that type is an array. And this array has two elements, and they're separated by a semicolon, and that really means that they are. It's going to be like a column vector. We're going to use an array, and we're going to express it or use it as a column vector. So this thing on the right is an array. This is one instance of an array. So I am assigning an instance of an array to a computer variable, u. That u just denotes there's some physical space in memory. And we're going to store this instance of this array into that computer variable, into that space. And you can see the return there is a 64-bit integer array. 3, 2, and if I twirl that down, you'll see the first value is 3, the second value is 2, denoting this idea of this being a column vector. If we use the type of function u there, we see indeed that'll tell you if you pass anything to it, to the type of function, it'll tell you what kind of Julia data type this is. And it says, well, it's an array of 64-bit integers along axis 1. Now, axis 1 is the column axis. As soon as you have rows or different columns, more than one column, that becomes axis 2, and that'll change to a 2, and that's how you'll get a matrix or a row vector. We'll see that later. So just to show you that we've created this vector, this column vector, but it is in actual fact an array. So we can also just use the vector function, uppercase V. Again, I'm now just going to use this array notation, and I'm just going to separate things by a comma. And that's just an alias for what we've done right up there. Just note the difference, but what we have is exactly the same thing. And if we see the type of vector and then this list of elements 3, 2, that's still going to be an array of 64-bit integers along one axis 1. So let's look at our first problem then. And so you might get that you have this vector in R4 with components 3, 3, negative 1, and 2. And we want to know what is the magnitude of that vector. Now, first of all, you can't really visualize that vector because where are you going to put the fourth dimension? But it's no problem in mathematics. And we're just going to use the Pythagorean theorem. Or we weigh up again here with this equation we had, equation 5. Remember, that's how to do it. So all we're going to do, we're just going to square all those components, and we're going to add that and take the square root of that, and that's approximately 4.796. That's, of course, tedious to do. Maybe you'll have to do it in pencil and paper, pen and paper. But, of course, in Julia here, I can use the norm function. And the norm function, because the norm of a vector is the same as the magnitude of a vector, use it in slightly different context. But anyway, I'm just passing this column vector to it. And now remember, I'm using this notation, the square bracket notation, where I put semicolons in between each of these values. So the 3, the 3, the negative 1, and the 2, all the components, I pass that as an argument to the norm function. And when I execute that, I get the result there, 4.796, rounded off. And that's exactly what we get there, if you did it by hand and used a calculator or whatever. Of course, this is Julia. Let me just show you. So let's just add a new little line right there. I'm going to go to that plus symbol there. And what is the square root of 23? So SQRT is the function for square root. I'm going to say 23. I'm going to hold down shift and hit return or shift enter. And there we go. We see the result there. So I really wasn't lying. So that norm function is, no matter what vector you give it, or array, then a column, with column values, you're gonna get the solution. So we also talked about the idea of the direction a vector takes. Now, once again, if we scroll all the way back up, very easy to do with trigonometry, because we still have right angle triangle, and we have this length, the y length, we have the x length, and in trigonometry, that's just the opposite and adjacent angles. And the tangent of this angle here would be opposite divided by adjacent. So that's as simple, really as simple as that. So the tangent of that angle is y over x, the y component over the x component. And if we take the inverse tangent function, or the arctangent function of that, we just get the angle. So here we have another little problem. Calculate the direction of the vector in the first quadrant with components x equals 3 and y equals 2. Well, very easy. I'm going to use the a-tan function. A tan for inverse tangent or arctangent, and I'm going to say 2 over 3. And remember, you don't have a symbol on your keyboard, a divide symbol. So we just use the forward slash 2 divided by 3, and that gives me this solution in radians. And if you want it in degrees, there's also the rad 2 deg radians 2 degrees function. And then I pass this calculation, A tan of 2 over 3 to it. And I see it's about 33.69 degrees. Very simple to do. Let's do another problem. Calculate the direction of the vector in the second quadrant of the plane. So components x equals negative 3 and y equals 2. So now what happens is we're interested in the angle between the positive x-axis and this vector pointing towards the point from the origin to the point negative 3, 2. So we're going to have this obtuse angle. You're always going to go from the positive x-axis counterclockwise. That's what we're interested in quadrants 1 and 2. But we see we get this result, negative 0.58. So what that is telling us, what that result is showing us, if we just think about the inverse tangent function, is that's going to give us the angle going in a clockwise direction from the negative x-axis up to our vector. And to get the expression that we really want, we've just got to add pi radians to that, and that's going to give us the other side, in other words, from the positive x-axis all the way around counterclockwise to the vector. So we get the real solution there, 2.55 radians. Now we're going to get to quadrants 3 and 4. Now there we express things differently. So in quadrants 1 and 2, we want this idea of going counterclockwise from the positive x-axis. So we're going to get this acute angle in quadrant 1 and this obtuse angle in quadrant 2. But if we get to quadrant 3 and 4, what we actually want to do there is still go from the positive x-axis, but go downwards clockwise to the vector. And then, because it's clockwise, we want that expressed as negative angles. So in the fourth quadrant, it'll be this negative acute angle, and in the third quadrant, it's this negative obtuse angle. So let's just see. So we've got this idea of, where were we? We've got this calculate the direction of the vector in the third quadrant of the plane with components x equals negative 3 and y equals negative 2. So if we do that, we get this solution, 0.58. But what that is going to do, that's again, that is from the negative x-axis going counterclockwise. And that's not what we want. We want from the positive x-axis going downwards clockwise to that. So what do we have to do? We've got to add that to negative pi radians. And I've shown you pi there all along. Let me just show you how nice it is to get a pi symbol in code. That's something you can't do in many other languages. I'm going to just hit in a code cell my backslash and then pi and then the tab symbol, and that should give me pi, and there we go, pi. And if I just do that, it's going to give me an approximation for the value of pi. So that's as simple as that to get pi. And if I go just there, I can just delete that cell. So it's negative pi plus that arctangent, and then we're going to get the real solution, negative 2.55 radians. So it's going from the positive x-axis counterclockwise, clockwise, I should say, downwards, this obtuse angle. And then when we get to the fourth quadrant, say x equals 3, y equals negative 2, we get this value that we're interested in, this negative acute angle, positive x-axis downwards clockwise to that. So the only place that we need to make changes is in the second and third quadrants. So using the arctangent function. So in the second quadrant, we're going to add pi to the solution. And in the third quadrant, we're going to add negative pi to it. So if you remember that, you're never going to make a mistake in calculating the correct angles or expressing them correctly. So when are vectors equal? So we see these two vectors there. Now, I think you would agree just looking at it, and that is how I designed them. They're pointing in the same direction, and they have the same magnitude. In vectors for us, from a linear algebra point of view, those are exactly the same thing. So I can have this translation on in space or on the plane, but it remains the same vector. I can move that so the tail of the bottom one, the purple one, the vector 2 is also at the origin, and then those two points, the two heads will coincide, and we have exactly the same vector. So vectors, no matter where I draw them on the plane, if they have the same magnitude and same direction, they're exactly the same thing. Nothing changes, and you see my little argument there. So if that P, I've got the vector P, the point P and the point Q. So P would be at 0, 0, and Q would be at 3, 2. So that would be this 0, 0 there and 3, 2. Okay, if I look at the vector PQ, that'll be just Q1 minus Q2 and Q1 minus P1 and Q2 minus P2. And that gives us this 3, 2 because it's 3 minus 0 and 2 minus 0. And if I have this P point P prime and P and Q prime, P prime sub 1 being negative 1, P prime sub 2 being negative 1, and you see the values there for Q prime, the two points. But if I do the subtraction once again, I also end up at 3, 2. So really PQ equals P prime Q prime. But you can see that so intuitively there. Same direction, same magnitude, it's exactly the same vector. That brings us just to this idea of row vectors. So we express them as a column. And mathematical, if we do some calculations in future notebooks, if we get there, row vectors become quite important as well. And we can take a column vector and we have this operation called the transpose. So you just make the column into a row. So every column component becomes an element in the row component. So remember U, there was U, and it was 3, 2. I can twirl it down, it's 3, 2. And now you use the transpose on that. And now it becomes this 64-bit integers. In an array, so it's an array of 64-bit integers expressed in this way, 3, 2. And so instead of it being a column there, you see it's now a row. And this is how you do it. There's equation 8 should make it all clear. I have this vector u and r in space, u1, u2, all the way to un. And I take the transpose of that, so that'd be u and then this superscript uppercase t. And every element there in the column becomes an element in the row. So as simple as that, U transpose. And that becomes a useful thing to do. Now let's look at a bit of vector arithmetic. Very important. So we're going to start by looking at vector addition. And we see how we define vector addition. This is how we define it. And it's very intuitive as well from figure number 5. So I've got my two vectors here, this one at the bottom, this red one, and then this purple one here. And all I'm doing, this purple one was also expressed as a position vector. So its tail was also down here and its head was somewhere here. But we just move it so that its tail is at the head of the first vector. And then if we add them, it's just adding the x components of the two and adding the y components of the two to get this top one, this resultant vector. So if you look at equation 9 there, we just add the two components, u1 and v1, u2 and v2, all the way down. So for all, so this upside down A, that means for all, let me just show you the LaTeX for that. That's all the LaTeX there. If you get your hands on the notebook, you can study that. So we're just adding these components, as you can see. So for all u and v elements of Rn, it follows that u plus v is that. We're just adding the components, and from this figure, it should make intuitive sense. So we are tasked in problem 6 with creating two random vectors in R4, and we're going to add them. So In the random package, there's this idea of this function random.seed exclamation mark. That exclamation mark is called a bang. And you can pass to that any integer. I'm passing 12 to it. So if I execute that, and then I use the random package to generate random values, well, the pseudo-random values, it's going to generate the same values every time because I've seeded the pseudo-random number generator. So what are we going to do? Rand function there from the rand package. We use a unit range, 1 colon 5. And because we don't have a step size, the default step size of this unit range is 1. So from 1 to 5, it will have elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I'm saying, take from the elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and give me 4 back at random, please. So what happens is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 is in a bucket, piece of papers, you know, 5 pieces of paper. And I draw a piece of paper, and the first one was a 5. So I jot it down, throw the 5 back, mix them up again, draw at random again. So every time, each of those 5 values has an equal likelihood of being chosen. So what it came up with was 5424, and if you seeded the pseudo-random number generator with 12 as well, you're going to get exactly the same random values. I've created another vector, vector underscore 2, and again, just from the random rand function, again with the same unit range, 4 values, and it gave me vector 1543. And I just say vector 1 plus vector 2, and indeed, 5, there's the 5, the first component. There we go, the 5 plus the 1, that's the 6, that's how I get with this, the 6. The 4, the 5 is 9, etc. Very simple, but if you do that in code, it's even simpler. Vector underscore 1 plus vector underscore 2 is going to give you that column vector, very simple. Scalar vector multiplication is just as simple. So we're going to take this scalar, C, element of a real number, and U, that's an element of any arbitrary vector then in space. It follows that CU equals just multiplying every component by that scalar. And that scalar vector multiplication, as simple as that. So problem 7, multiply vector 1 by 3. That'll just be 3 times vector 1. As simple as that. And each element in vector 1 is now just multiplied by 3. What does that do, though? So one reason to like these Pluto notebooks is that you have the Pluto UI package that we imported, and that allows us to create this variable C here, and we're going to use the macro at bind, and we're going to bind to C this slider, and the slider uses a unit range from negative 2 to 2. As I said, we don't have a step size, so the step size by default is 1, so negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, and 2. So this slider is going to be linked to that, to those values. So what I've done here at the bottom is I've created this vector 2,2, but I'm multiplying each one of them by C. So what I'm doing here is this vector 2,2, and all we're doing to this vector, we're scaling it. So that'll be negative 2 times the vector 2,2, and that'll be negative 1. Now it gets a bit shorter. 0, there's no vector, because if I 0 times 2 is 0, 0 times 2 is 0. 1, there's my original vector, and it scales. So what does scalar vector multiplication do? Well, it just scales a vector, makes it shorter and longer, doesn't change the direction, in as much as the line that runs through that, it can go in the 180 degrees or pi radians opposite direction by making the scalar negative, for sure, but it stays in that same line. So we can also then think of what it does to the magnitude. So the magnitude of this scalar vector multiplication is just take that vector and just multiply it by the scalar, the magnitude of that vector multiplied by the scalar, as simple as that. And that gives us this idea of how to subtract vectors from each other. Because what I can do is I can just multiply the second vector by negative 1, the scalar negative 1. Now it points in the opposite direction, so instead of a plus v, I have a plus negative v, and that's the same as, or u plus negative v, that would be same as u minus v, exactly the same thing. U minus v is just u plus scalar vector multiplication at the end, negative 1 times v. And that also gives us this sort of scalar vector division, in as long as that scalar is not zero, I can have this idea of dividing a vector by a scalar, and it's just this reciprocal, 1 over the scalar times u. So every element will just be multiplied by 1 over that scalar. So that's very simple vector addition. That's basically all we have, because vector subtraction is still vector addition by adding a bit of scalar vector multiplication and just making that scalar negative 1. So we only have these two operations, basically vector addition and scalar vector multiplication. Now we get to something a bit different, and that's the dot product between two vectors. And you'll have to do a lot of examples, I think, in your exams, etc., of dot product, and the other one is a cross product. So let's start with the dot product, and we see the definition here in equation 14. So for all vectors u and v, element in Rn, so you can take any two vectors in that space, as far as that u dot v, we write that as the u transpose dot v. And what that really is, and when we get to matrices, we'll see what that really means, is that we just multiply the components pair by pair, and we just add all of those. So u1 times v1 plus u2 times v2 plus. So you can see the answer is going to be a scalar. So let's look at problem 8. So we asked to generate two vectors in R4 and calculate their dot product. So again, I'm going to seat the pseudo-random number generator. I'm going to use the rand function twice and just generate these four. Now, I've just said 1 to 5, but you can choose any unit range you want so that you don't just get elements between 1 and 5. You can make negative 5 to 5, whatever you want. But four elements, that's important. So I've got my two vectors again, and because the pseudo-random number generator was seeded with a value 12, we get exactly the same two vectors as before. And then to do the dot product is very simple, in as much as we use the dot function. Dot function, and then we just put in these two vectors separated by a comma, and we get the answer 45. And here we go. I'm just going to show you. There's my two column vectors that we generated up there. So it's 5 times 1 plus 4 times 5 plus 2 times 4 plus 4 times 3. That's 5. Plus 20, plus 8, plus 12, and that gives us 45, and there's the dot product's 45. No problem. So what about the dot product of a vector with itself? So we read here, the dot product has some interesting properties. First, the dot product of a vector with itself is always positive, or it can be zero. So I'm talking u dot u. Now, it's always positive because what we're doing is component times component. In other words, that's component square if the vector is dotted with itself. And square is always positive, so we're always going to get a positive, and the only way that we can get zero is if it's the zero vector. And lo and behold, the zero vector, of course, does exist. All the elements are just zero. So if we look at u dot u there, and if the vector is 3, 4, negative 3 in problem 8, it's 3 squared plus 4 squared plus negative 3 squared, and that gives us 34. And again, if I do that with a dot product, I'm going to get the same answer, 34, as simple as that. So in actual fact, what we're doing here is just taking the dot product as nothing other than just taking the magnitude of the vector and squaring it. As simple as that. Another interesting fact that we'll see here is if the two vectors are orthogonal, which is a fancy word for perpendicular to each other, their dot product will always be zero. Or then if you do the dot product between two non-zero vectors and it turns out to be zero, you know that those two vectors are orthogonal to each other. And you can see the code there. So let's take these two. They're clearly orthogonal, 3 and 5 and negative 5 and 3. And if you take the dot product between those, it's 0. Now, there's three more properties that you'll see in your textbook. Is that there's this commutative property in vector, the dot product between two vectors. We have this distribution over addition. So u dot v plus w, that should be u dot v plus u dot w, and this distribution of the scalar as well, as you can see there. So let's look at the dot product a bit differently, because what is it? I mean, we're just multiplying the component-wise and adding all the products, but what is it? And the first way we're going to look at it is just this: the dot product is a function of the angle between two vectors. I mean, what we're going to do is we're going to use this the law of cosines. So if I have two sides of a triangle, A and B, and the angle between them being theta, and then opposite theta we'll get the other side of the triangle, we'll call that C, and then we get this idea of the law of cosines, that c squared equals a squared plus b squared minus 2bc cosine theta. Now think about a triangle. Let's make a the length of a. Let's make a a vector and b a vector and c a vector. And if a is a vector, its length is going to be the magnitude of a, and the length of the side b is going to be the magnitude of the vector b, and then c. And I want you to play with it. C would be a minus b. So draw yourself on paper some vectors and look at a minus b. So that's a plus negative b. And translate that vector and you'll see it neatly forms that third side of the triangle. So to write this out, c would then be, c squared would be a minus b, that magnitude of that difference squared. A squared would be the magnitude of a squared. B would be the magnitude of b squared minus 2bc. So there should be bc there. So let's fix that. So that's minus 2. Oh, ab is right. Up there should be ab. There we go. Minus 2ab. There we go. Fixed. C squared equals a squared plus b squared minus 2ab cosine theta. And that's what we have there. But let's look at what in equation 9, what a minus b is. Remember, that will be component-wise subtraction. a1 minus b1 and a2 minus b2 as a vector. And if we take the magnitude of this a minus b, which is c, there'll be a1 minus b1 squared plus a2 minus b2 squared, and add that and take the square root of all of that. And if we square both sides, that's what we have. And if on the right-hand side we just expand these two squares, that's what we get. And we just group these terms together, then we get a1 squared plus a2 squared. Well, that's the magnitude of a squared. B sub 1 squared plus b sub 2 squared. Well, that's the magnitude of b squared. And minus 2 times a1 b1 plus a2 b2. Well, what is that? Well, that's a dot b. So this is what we have left. So now a minus b magnitude squared, we have two equations for it. There's 1 in 18 and there's 2 in number 2 and 19. So we just equate these two to each other so that these magnitude squares, they all cancel out. The negative 2s cancel out. And I have this new way to look at the dot product. The dot product is the magnitude of a times the magnitude of b times the cosine of the angle between them. Or we can just take the arc cosine, take the magnitudes towards the other side and take the arc cosine or inverse cosine function, and that gives me theta. So let's just do that, calculate the angle between these two vectors. So that's very simple, and you can see the code for it there using the arc acos for arc cosine or inverse cosine function. I'm taking the dot product of those two vectors and I'm dividing it by the product of the two magnitudes using the norm function. And again, I can express this as radians 2 degrees with that function, and that gives us 38 degrees. As simple as that. The Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, you see that there. You might be asked to do that, and there's a little problem for you there using the dot product. And we also get this Minkowski triangle inequality, which you see there. Now, I don't do any proofs in this video set, but let me know if you want a video on how to do the proofs of these. They actually quite fun to do. But you can see that we have this little problem 11 then, the solution just taking the norm of the addition and then the addition of the norms there. And you'll see, of course, that one is smaller than the other. I skip over those quite quickly because what I want to get to really is this idea of orthogonal projections, because that's really what a dot product is. Remember, we're getting a scalar out. So let's look at these two. I have vector W in this image here and vector A there. And I can take this idea of the orthogonal component of W along A. So from W, I draw this line down to A and it's orthogonal to A so that I can decompose W into two components so that the one component is along A and the other component is, of course, orthogonal to A. So what the dot product really is and what we're going to see is really the multiplication of the component of W along A called the projection of W along A and multiplied by A. And let me let the cat out the bag. If you think of physics, work equals force times distance, but it's only the component of the force along the displacement, force times displacement, but only the component of the force along the displacement contributes to the work. And now you can think why, if I have two orthogonal vectors, that their dot product is zero. Because if my force is totally orthogonal to the displacement, that force is doing no work whatsoever because there's no component of that force along the displacement vector. Anyway, if you have a PNG file saved on your hard drive, you can use this local resource function. And that local resource function is, of course, a function in the Pluto UI package. And you can just reference it where it is on your hard drive, and it'll draw the figure for you, the PNG file for you there. So that is the derivation of this idea of the projection of W along A. So W, if you think of W, I can deconstruct it into U plus V. In other words, U is W minus V. Just a bit of simple algebra. So U, remember, that is the projection of W along A, and that's how we write it, proj of W along A. So the little subscript A there, that is U. It's a different notation for U, so that's W minus V. But if you think of what U is, it's now along A, so it's just a scalar multiple of A. So we can write it as K times A. And that K times A there, remember that K is just a scalar. So now that we have another way to write U, we started with W equals U plus K, so we can rewrite W equals KA plus V. So what are we going to do if we have W dot A? That's what we're interested in here. Well, I have W written differently here. KA, K times A plus V dot A. So it's just rewriting W because we've got another way to write W there. And if I do this, we've looked at those properties, that will be K times A dot A plus V dot A. Look back at those properties. And A dot A, remember that's the square of the magnitude. So I have K times the square of that magnitude of A plus VA. But V and A, they're orthogonal to each other if you look at the image. So that's zero. So just solving for K, I have K equals W dot A divided by the magnitude square of A. So we have what K is. Now we can just put K back into what we have here, U equals K times A. So U being the projection of W along A, that is the dot product of W and A, divided by the magnitude of A squared times A. So W dot A, that is going to give us a dot product, that is a scalar, divided by the magnitude, that's a scalar. So we have this big scalar, times A. And that's exactly what U is. It's this scaled version of A. Now we can also work out this idea of the magnitude of the projections. So we just take the projection here of U. And so that will be, we can also put double lines there. Which means we can take this A out as on the right hand side here as a magnitude. And we have a magnitude over magnitude squared, so that's going to cancel. So this length of this component, this length of this component of W long A, or the length of U, we see there as the absolute value of that dot product divided by A's magnitude. And that's exactly where we get this idea of work equals force times difference, times the displacement, those vectors. So it's this idea of W, if W was the force and A is the displacement, it's this idea here. I'm just bringing the A over to the other side of the projection. So you get this idea of what the dot product is used for. So instead of the dot product, we also get the cross product, but first we just have to look at the unit vectors, and that's just taking a vector and scaling it down so that its magnitude is 1. And the way that we do that is we just take a vector and we divide it by And we've already seen this 1 over c times a vector, so it's a type of scalar vector multiplication. But at the bottom, we have the magnitude of u. So each component is just going to be divided by the magnitude. And then we put this little hat symbol on top of it, and it's no longer boldface, and that's the unit vector of u. So it's still in the same direction as u, it just has now has a magnitude of 1. So there's problem 12. I have u, and that is 3, 4, and 0. And I just want the magnitude of that, so I'll take the norm of that. So I've created the vector underscore u there, take the norm of that, the norm is 5. And so I'm going to take vector u and divide it by 5. So each component is going to be divided by 5. And then I get 0.6, 0.8, and 0. So that's still in the same direction. It is just now has unit length. So its magnitude is 1. Of course, if we think of the three axes of the Cartesian space, or the Cartesian plane then, with this two component, we have this unit vectors along each of the axes, and we call those the unit basis vectors, and we write those as I hat, J hat, and K hat, and you can see the components there making absolute sense, because we have now this idea of the cross product. So what you what happens is with a cross product is, a cross product is orthogonal to the plane created by the two vectors that you're taking the cross product on. So if the two cross products are in the plane, the result will be perpendicular to the plane. So I need that to have that third dimension. And it's also the right-hand rule, and your thumb points in the direction. We write it as u cross v, as you can see there. And we do that by taking the determinant of this matrix here. But we haven't studied matrices, so I can't really explain to you what's going on there. Just trust me then that if you take the determinant of this matrix and you write on the first row the three unit basis vectors, and as row vectors you write the two others, now you have a little 3x3 matrix. You take the determinant of that, and that is just going to give you the cross product. We can also very easy in Julia just use the cross function, create my two vectors, and the cross function cross with that would be, now look at this, my vectors were along 2, 1, 0. So I've got to express, even though those vectors are on the plane, I've got to express them as vectors in 3 space, in R3, because my result is going to be in R3. So I have these two vectors on the in the plane, but look at their cross product. It'll have 0, 0 in the xy plane, their components, but negative 5 in the z component. So it is going to be orthogonal to the plane. So what's the physical interpretation, even though we can't yet explain exactly what's going on here before we've looked at matrices, is that if I have these two vectors, now look at this vector down the bottom here, and this red vector going there, and all I've done is I've completed them by translation so that I can form this parallelogram. So this parallelogram has an area, and the base of it is, well, there's the point 3, so it has a base of 3 and a height of 2. So it's base times perpendicular height, 3 times 2 is 6. The area of this parallelogram formed by these two vectors, these two position vectors, the red one here and the brown one down here, they form a parallelogram if we extend it and translate the two of them. And the area of that, well, that's the cross product. We said it was 6, and lo and behold, if you take the cross product of those two vectors, 3 and 0 and 5 and 2, you get the norm of that magnitude, the norm of that vector, that would just be 6. Its length is 6. And that magnitude, at least, is the area of this parallelogram, the magnitude of the cross product. Then we get this thing called the scalar triple product. So I'm going to take first the cross product between two vectors and that resultant orthogonal vector to those two vectors. I dot that with u, and then I get the scalar triple product. And this is how we do it, the determinant of the three vectors written here as row vectors. And if I get that determinant, that's going to give me the scalar triple product. And what that really is those three vectors, if they're all position vectors, they form a parallelepiped. And this scalar triple product, which is a scalar, gives me the volume of that parallelepiped. Which brings us to this last idea of spanning. Now, if I think of the vectors, the unit vectors, basis unit vectors, I hat and j hat, a linear combination of them, and this is a linear combination, is that I just take a vector and I multiply it by a scalar and another vector multiplied by a scalar and I add that. That I can get to any vector or any point in the plane. So a linear combination of vectors. So I take 1 comma 0, that's the unit vector along the x-axis, and I multiply it by some value, say 3, that ends me up at 3 comma 0, and I add to that 3 times the unit vector on the y-axis, which is 0, 1. That gives me, say, I multiply that by 5. So that becomes 0, 5, and 0, 5 and 3, 0 leaves me at 3, 5. So I can get to the vector 3, 5. So I can get to anywhere with these two basis vectors. And what we say about them is they span the whole of R2. Those two vectors span because a linear combination of them can get to any vector in the plane. So if I use I, j, and k, so 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1 as my three standard basis vectors in R3. A linear combination of them can get to a vector anywhere in space, in three space, anywhere. Those three vectors span the space. Alternatively, we say they are a basis for that space. And it's because they are linearly independent. And when are vectors linearly independent? Well, we can test for that, and that's in a future notebook, is that one cannot be written as a linear combination of the other. There's no way with a vector I hat to get a linear combination of it. In other words, multiplying it by a scalar, adding another multiple of it to it, and another multiple of it. I can never get to 1, 0. There's just no way. I can never get away from the x-axis if I just have 1, 0. In other words, these two vectors are linearly independent of each other. And if they're linearly independent of each other, then they form this basis of, they are a basis of that space. And we'll review all of that because it becomes very important. This notebook is all about the intuition, though, that somehow that you can develop this idea in your head that they span a space because a linear combination of them can reach anywhere in that space. So, three things you've learned here. First of all, this is the idea behind this is vectors in Euclidean space. Then, how to use a notebook to generate your notes so that they look very nice. And then, how to just use Julia code to do all your work for you. So you might have to do it in pen and paper, but you can just always just verify your work with a single line of code. And having your notes as neat as this, being able to visualize it and check your results with some code, I think that's a very neat way of understanding your mathematics and doing your mathematics.